Welcome, everybody. We are glad you're here with us this morning. If you're here in the building, we're glad you're here. If you're watching us online, we're glad you're here as well. We welcome our visitors and glad you have chosen to be with us this morning. We always appreciate having people come by and spend some time in worship with us on Sunday mornings. It is great to have you because there are so many other options that you could be doing, and so we're glad you've chosen to be here with us. I'm trying to get smart and use my phone to keep my messages, and as challenged as I am with this phone that is so much smarter than I am, it is really a challenge. A couple of announcements before we get into our worship today. The good times first. Many of you have been talking about wanting to sing and sing better and sing without these masks once in a while, and so June the 5th from 5 o'clock, starting at 5 o'clock, we're going to have an outside singing. We're going to sing out on the ground here in front of the building. We're going to just enjoy that time. We're not only going to sing for a while, but then we're going to feed you hamburgers and hot dogs. The church will supply all of that. You don't need to bring anything but your appetite. We're going to open it up to the congregation and chairs. Thank you. We would ask you bring your folding chairs, chairs you want to sit on, and you'll set them out on the lawn out in front. I believe Daniel and Rachel will set everything up right here in the alcove outside, and they will be spread out on the front. Again, we're inviting the town to come join us, and so we're hoping to have a real good sing. I know a lot of us have missed singing without these masks, and so we're going to try to do that June the 5th. So start now praying for good weather. Praying it doesn't rain that afternoon, and we will be looking forward to that. We'll sing first, and then we'll eat after that, because I don't know about you, but I have a hard time stuffing myself and then trying to sing. So we'll do it that way. Veronica's out of town today, if you're missing her. Or if you're not missing her, she's still out of town. And it's good to see Donnie and Rhonda back from Florida. Glad you're back here with us. Glad you had a safe trip. Y'all keep Dennis and Mary Lou in your prayers. If you saw her email, they traveled down to Florida. They got there safely, but somewhere along the way they had an accident and totaled their trailer. So they're staying in their trailer. It's not unlivable, but it's untowable. So the insurance company has totaled it. And when they get done staying down there, they'll leave it down there and drive back home. But they did not get hurt at all, and so we're thankful for that. But if you, I'm sure they'd appreciate our prayers as well. Valerie, our daughter Valerie, sent us a text this morning. And they had a friend by the name of Heidi Smith who was found unresponsive this morning. She's at Bristol Memorial Hospital. They're doing tests on her to see if there's any brain activity or not, and then they'll have to make a decision then on what to do with her. And Valerie asked if we would pray for Heidi and for that family, if you would, please. And then the bad news. I loved Mac. As did the rest of you, all of you who knew with him. Our services for Mac, who passed away this last Tuesday, will be tonight at 6 o'clock at Dillo Taylor here in Jonesboro. The interment is tomorrow at 10 at Monte Vista, which is up on Oakland, up in Johnson City. It's an open service, so anyone can come if you'd like to. They're not worrying about COVID situations, so you're welcome to come tonight at 6 o'clock. The viewing will be from 4 to 6. And then the service will start sometime after 6 o'clock. So you're welcome to come sit with Becky. Becky's doing well. She's handling this as well as she can. They're blessed to have all their family close by, and so certainly they're being cared for and loved on. But I know they would appreciate your prayers as we say goodbye to Mac. Because of that, we will not be having our usual Sunday night small group meeting this evening. Let's go to God in prayer. God, we are so thankful that you love us. So thankful, Father, that we can gather here as part of your family and praise you and fellowship with each other, encourage one another. And Father, I just pray this morning especially that you will be with Becky and with Jacob and with Ashley and the rest of the family as they transition to having a life here on earth without Mac. I pray, God, your comfort upon all of us. Pray your blessings upon us as we contemplate his life and as we go through these next months and times, Father, as we realize he's gone. Father, I do offer a prayer for Heidi Smith, for Valerie's friend. And God, you know what's going on there. You know what's best for them and for that family. So, Father, we pray your will in that matter. But I know, Father, we would pray that you would heal her, that she would regain consciousness, that she would be okay. But God, I pray your blessings upon the family, that you'll be with them and help them as they go through this time of transition as well. God, help us this morning to pay attention to you. Help us to give you the glory. Help us as we sing to be reminded that we're not only praising you, Father, but in some of these songs we'll be encouraging each other, helping one another get through the trials of the day and join in celebrating you. So God, we just offer you that praise today in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to sing a few of my favorite hymns this morning, and then we're going to sing a couple of modern songs. If you need to sit, have a seat during any moment, feel free to do that. And quick PSA, if you have, you have not lived until you played Mexican Train at the Roberson's house, okay? So if you have not done that, that's what you need to do right there. So also, they did. Yeah, it was great. Speaking of winning, we have a victory in Jesus, and we're going to sing about that this morning. Let's all stand and sing.
Victory. Oh, victory in wonderful, the matchless grace of Jesus, deeper than the mighty rolling sea, higher than the mountains, sparkling like a fountain, all sufficient grace for even me, broader than the scope of my transgressions, greater far than all my sin and shame. Oh, magnify the precious name of Jesus, praise His name. Wonderful.
Thank you.
thank you so much, Lord, for your grace. Your kindness knows no end. We praise you this morning. We thank you for this time together. I pray this in your name. Amen.
It would be time for children's worship. You know, if you grew up in a typical home, if you hung around people that did, you heard phrases frequently that went something like, "It's not fair. She always gets to be first. How come he gets the biggest piece? It's always my fault. He never gets in trouble." And you sort of hope that as children outgrow that age and they turn into teenagers, they become these precious, wonderful things that never cause us any trouble. Instead, although the words change, the attitude doesn't very much. Susie's daddy always lets her stay out past 10. How come I can't go to the party? Everybody's going to the party but me. Why can't I have a phone? Everybody's got a phone. When am I going to get my car? And on the question goes. And although they're teenagers, in reality, they're still fighting that battle of looking at each other and judging their lives by what's going on around them. What does other people get to do? Why can't I have all this fun that everybody else seems to be having? How come I get the only strict parents on the face of the earth? And of course, that all goes away as we get older, right? We become adults and we realize we don't have to play those games. Instead, we look around and we say, "The Joneses got a new house. When are we going to get a new house? Have you seen the car the Smiths are driving across the road? I'm still driving that 1997 Nova. When am I going to get a new car?" Or maybe at work it's something like, "How come she got that promotion? I've been here a lot longer than she has, and I know a whole lot more. I can only imagine why she got the job." Or maybe, "How come Bob got the raise and I didn't get a raise?" And we can fill in the blanks about whatever it is that bugs us, because we're still, even as we get older, looking around the world, imagining how everybody else measures up to me. And if I'm not getting something I want, or someone else is getting something more than I have, I'm frustrated. I'm angry. I'm disappointed. I'm anything but joyful. Church, I don't know about you, but I want that joy that Jesus says we can have all the time. I want to be able to live a kind of life that enables me to be at peace and to be at rest and to have that understanding that my God loves me and all of this stuff in the world really doesn't matter. But church, I got to tell you, I haven't got there yet, and I suspect many of you haven't either. We are still looking around at other people thinking, "How come they got this? How come they have that? How come this doesn't happen to them? How come it's always me that seems to get the short end of the stick?" And we can go on and on and on as we think about those things. Many years ago, Irma Bombeck wrote a book entitled, "The Grass is Always Greener, Just Above the Septic Tank." But you know, we're always looking at that greener grass, aren't we? We always think that somehow if I could just have something else, if I could just have a little bit more, if I could just qualify for what it seems like everybody else just gets without even having to try. And I'm sitting here beating myself up, working myself to death over and over and over again, and I don't ever seem to get ahead. In fact, every time I get a step ahead, I drop back two. And it seems like I never can achieve anything. We never can seem to get ahead. And it's all because, I suspect, we believe life is simply not fair. You ever told your kids that? You ever had somebody tell you that? You know, life's not fair. Get over it. Life's not fair. Live with it. Most of us know life is never really going to be fair all the time to every one of us. It can't work out that way. But I'm here this morning to share with you a little thought that maybe you've never thought about. God's not fair either. And before you start throwing hymnals at me, listen to the rest of the sermon, okay? Here's a passage that seems to share with us the fact that God's not fair as far as we in the world would measure fairness. And I didn't put this up on a slide because it's a long passage. So if you've got your Bible or your phone or an app or something you want to open up, go to Matthew chapter 20. This is the epitome of people looking around them and thinking, life's not fair. And looking at God maybe and thinking, life's not fair with him either. Beginning in verse 1 of Matthew chapter 20. It says, the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and sent them into his vineyard. About 9 in the morning, he went out and saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing. He told them, you also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right. And so they went. He went out again about noon and about 3 in the afternoon and did the same thing. About 5 in the afternoon, he went out and found still others standing around, and he asked them, why have you been standing around all day doing nothing? Because no one hired us, they answered. He said to them, you go also and work in my vineyard. When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and going on to the first. The workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came, and each received a denarius. So when those came who were hired first, they expected to receive more. But each of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. These who were hired last worked only an hour, they said. And you've made them equal to us who have borne the burden of work and the heat of the day. But he answered one of them, I'm not being unfair to you, my friend. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last. You know, in our world today, we think if I just work harder, I get more. If I've worked for a company longer, I should have more of an income. They should pay me more than the new guy. That's the struggle going on in America today as we look at raising minimum wage and bringing in people at a certain level. There's no way they're going to be able to raise everybody up that same amount. And so those who have been working for a long time are going to look around and say, how come they're getting as much or almost as much as I'm getting? And I've been here for 20 years. Life's not fair. And it isn't my fault that this is the way life is. If you're going to give them that much, you should raise my salary too. And I can already hear people complaining that I've worked for years and years and years, and the new people come in making more than I do. It happens in a lot of places, even without worrying about minimum wage. How can it be fair to pay someone who's worked all day long the same amount of money as someone gets who's only worked an hour? Where's the fairness in that? And as we look at it as far as the world is concerned, it's not fair at all. And so this morning, what I want us to do for a little bit is look at and contrast the fairness of the world with what God does with us. And I hope we'll realize by the time it's over, we really don't want God to be fair. We don't want fairness at all. You see, the first contrast is the world says everybody labors according to their own ability. And if you don't have any ability, you get left out. If you can't carry the load, if you can't do the work, if you can't do all the things you're being hired for, you're not only not either going to not get hired or you're going to be laid off before you know it. And so you've got to be able to qualify to get into that position. Some of us have been in that spot. You've applied for jobs and someone's told you you're just not qualified. Or maybe the most horrible thought, you're overqualified. We can't hire you because you've got too much education. You've got too much experience. We know you won't be satisfied with taking this job. But see, in God's kingdom, it says everybody is purposed for participation. It doesn't matter how qualified you may be. It doesn't matter how worthy you think you are. It doesn't matter how unworthy you think you are. In God's kingdom, God wants everybody to come in, and he's got a role for every single one of us. That's Paul's definition as he talked about the kingdom, the church being a body. Every piece of God's body has a role to play. It doesn't matter if you're a little toe or if you're a heart. Every part of the body of Christ has purpose. Every part of the body of Christ has a role. And if we will do the role we've been assigned to do, that's all God's asking for us. He does not expect everybody to be a heart. He does not expect everybody to be a leg. Paul says that when he writes the book. And he says, you know, if everybody was an eye, where would the hearing be? And obviously, we can all look around us and we look in the world and we think, I want to be like them. I want to be able to accomplish this. But in the body of Christ, that kind of competition has no place. Jesus said, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent his Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. God's desire is to save us all, not just the pretty people, not just the ones who can outwork the rest of us, not just those who have the drive to really get ahead. God wants all of us. Paul wrote in Ephesians, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us, all of us, in Christ Jesus with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose in him before the foundation of the world that we should be found holy and blameless before him. God's desire is that we be holy and blameless. And he makes us that. I love those songs we sang today. It's the sacrifice of Jesus on a cross that makes it possible for us to be holy and blameless. We don't get to be holy because we work harder. We don't get to be blameless because I do so many good deeds. Only through Jesus Christ am I holy and blameless. In the world, fairness says the slackers are going to fall by the wayside. We have no room for you. If you're not going to pull your own weight, get out. If you're not going to accomplish the task we've laid out before you, why don't you just quit? I can hire somebody else to take your place. And that happens all the time, doesn't it? Job turnover. People being moved out of the way. People being let go because there's somebody else who can do the job better. But in God's kingdom, he says, there is always room for more. Isn't it nice to know that God hadn't put a limit on how many people can be saved? Isn't it nice to know when God puts the call out there for laborers, there isn't a bottom line that says, I can only take the first 15. If you're not there by 10, don't bother showing up. That's the world's rule, but God says, I want everybody. In fact, it says, and the master said to the servant, go out into the highways and the byways, the hedges, and compel people to come in that my house may be filled. Jesus wants us all. He doesn't give you an entrance exam to see how good you are, how much you know, or what you're worth to him. Do you realize that to God, we can't add one thing to his power? We can't add one thing to his worth. We can't make God more God simply by being the people we are. And in spite of that, he says, I still want you. I still want you on my team. I still want you in my company. I still want you in my church. I still want you to be the body of Christ. I don't care that you think you can't do anything. That isn't the measure for being in God's kingdom. Bring me your homeless, your crippled, your tired, those who have just been beaten down by life, those who are caught up in all kinds of horrible things. bring them to me because I've got room for them. In the world, generally speaking, the pay that you get is based on merit, on your know-how, or maybe on who you know. How many of you, don't raise your hands. How many of you ever got a job because you knew somebody? You were able to get that recommendation from somebody who had some pull. And because you knew that person and that person was willing to say something good for you, you got a job all about who you know. But in God's kingdom, as we just read in that parable, it's all about getting paid the same from the master. It's all about the master wanting you, and all you need to know is him. We've all known people, I suspect, who have said things like, you know, my grandfather built this church. Don't tell me where I can sit. Or something more like, you know, if you knew how much money I gave into this church week after week after week, you would do things the way I wanted them done. People who think just because they've got power, they've got some stamina, or they've been able to do something that other people haven't been able to do, that somehow they're more worthy. Somehow God looks on them better than he does somebody else. But if there's any truth in the Bible, and I know that there is, God looks on every one of us the same. He loves us. He doesn't love you more than he loves me. He doesn't love me more than he loves you. God so loved the world. And by that, he means everybody in it. Every soul that's ever lived on this earth, God loves. And his desire is that they be saved. His desire is that they come into his kingdom. His desire is that you and I, who are in his kingdom, would go into all the world and make disciples. We would bring people to Christ. We would be the kind of people that would draw people to Jesus, not to us, not to our church, but to Jesus. You know, one of the saddest commentaries on Christianity is when a preacher who's been at a church a long time decides to quit, half the church goes. Because they're only there because they like the preaching. They're only there because they feel comfortable with the guy who's up front. This church belongs to Jesus. It doesn't belong to me. It doesn't belong to you. It belongs to him. And we need to be real careful that we don't measure our faithfulness based upon who's preaching today. Or what songs are we going to sing? Or what's the temperature going to be like inside? Or what time are we going to get out? And all these other things that we think we have a right to dictate to others because that's the fair way to do things. Jesus, or Paul, wrote, the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, his Son. Every one of us gets the same payment. We get saved. God will save every person who comes to him and who belongs to Jesus. You don't get saved more than somebody else. You don't get saved better than somebody else. If you're saved, you're saved. And that's what God wants from us. Paul wrote this to Timothy, or Titus, I'm sorry. In Titus chapter 3, it says, "For we ourselves," see if you fit any of this, "for we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by men and hating one another." Dang, I don't want to be around those people. But that's some nasty sounding people. Most of us would say, we don't want people like that in our church. You know, they can go to the Baptist church. They can go to the Methodist church. If that's the way they're going to be, we don't want them here. Because somehow, again, we think we're better than they are, don't we? If we're not careful, we think, I never did that. Because we forgot yesterday. You know, the older we get, the easier it is to forget yesterday. And if we're not careful, we think, I've never really done anything horrible. I've been this wonderful Christian man my whole life. God should be so thankful that I'm on his side. But we look at that list and we think, ugh, who would do that? We would do that. But he goes on and he says, but when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us. All those people, all that list of stuff, God saved us. Not because of the deeds done by us in righteousness, but in virtue of his own mercy. Daniel, I don't think you could have picked out many songs better than those we sang this morning on the mercy of God. And it's his mercy that saves us. Not my good deeds. Not how much I have to contribute. Not how much I can do. It's all the mercy of God. He goes on by saying, by the washing of regeneration, renewal in the Holy Spirit, which he poured out upon us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that we might be justified by grace and become heirs in hope of eternal life. And Paul writes a similar passage in several of the letters he wrote. He says, you used to be like this. You people who are now in Christ, you did all of these things. You were all these horrible things. But through the mercy of God, he accepted you as you were and he saved you. And his desire then is that you give up those things and live for him. And church, you're not more saved because you give up those things and live for him. God doesn't make you more of his child when you give away those bad things. You're his child, period. As long as your goal and your desire is to be with Jesus. Well, how does living right make any difference then? It brings you that peace and that joy that God says you can have. Most of us know when we're not living the way God wants us to. When we're doing things we're not supposed to be doing, we know it. And we know that joy and that peace and that closeness of that relationship with God isn't there. Because we feel something between us. It isn't that God's let us go. It isn't that he's slapped us down. It just, he knows the way for Christians to be joyful is to walk with God. But your sins don't separate you from God. We studied in 1 John for quite a while on Sunday night. And John wrote, the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin if we're in fellowship with him. All sin. All sin. How much sin is left out of all? None. You know, we've known Christians who have said, I'm just going to give up. I've done this, or I've done that, or I've done these things, and how could God possibly want me? You see, that's the attitude that says I'm going to judge God's fairness on the world's fairness. The world would say to us, I don't want you. If you've got that in your life, I don't want you. If you're that kind of a person, you have no place here. But God says, I want you, period. And if you'll let me, I'll cleanse you. If you'll let me, I'll make you righteous. Not because you are righteous, not because you do so much, but because the blood of Jesus will cleanse you of all unrighteousness. The world says, first come, first served. I almost had to tell somebody that's the way it works in the world. Yesterday, Friday, actually. Veronica and I were in line. She got her first COVID shot Friday afternoon. And it's in a drive-through tent area. And we're in line, and there's one line of cars, and we're in it. And the people are taking us one at a time, and I'm thanking God I've already got my shots. They're out of the way. I don't have to worry about it because I'm watching this needle that's about 38 inches long. And I know what they're going to be doing to Veronica before they know it. And as we're in this line of cars, here comes this guy, drives right past us, goes right up to the front of the line on the other side. I think to myself, you're not getting in front of me. I was here first. Isn't that what we would all think? We've been in line. It's our turn. Who do you think you are? I'm thanking God the person who was moving cars ahead basically ignored that guy until the cars who were already in line got through ahead of him. But my first inclination was first come, first serve. And I've been here longer, and I want to go home. Jesus says, the greatest in the kingdom is servant of all. That's probably one of the most difficult things Christian people have to do. You've got to learn to serve. You've got to learn it's not all about you. You have to learn that you can't just because you've been here longer or you're more important or you're richer or you've got a big house somewhere that somehow you qualify to be served by the others in the church. Every one of us are made to be servants in God's kingdom. In fact, Matthew 20 later on it says, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Jesus, when he was with his disciples there at the end and he's going to wash the disciples' feet, and Peter said, no way are you going to wash my feet. You are not going to serve me by washing my feet. And Jesus said, if I don't wash your feet, you're not part of me. The message Jesus was giving Peter and all of us was that people who make up God's kingdom are servants. We're not here to be served by one another. It's not all about me. It's not all about my desires. It's all about us taking care of one another, making sure we meet the needs of as many people as we can. That's how God works it out. Teresa sent me a song last week that I listened to, and really that song was what gave me the idea of doing this sermon today. It was a Blake Shelton song. Anybody know Blake Shelton? Country Western singer. The song was entitled Bible Verses. And you almost have to listen to the song to get the gist of it. But generally speaking, it's, you know, I want to read the Bible. I want to read the good book. I want to read these Bible verses. And I wrote it, want to read them in order to feel good about them instead of reading that it's the Bible verses me. You ever thought about it that way? So many people, it is that way, isn't it? It's the Bible versus me. I can never measure up to that list of things to do. I can never let go of all those sins in my life that the Bible says I need to let go of. And as we read the book, we get that attitude that it's me against the Bible. And God's going to measure me up by what's in that book. And I'm going to have to stand there someday. And the book's going to be opened up. And God's going to go down the list, and then he's going to look at me, and he's going to say, well, you didn't do this one, you didn't do this one, you didn't do this one. Or you did do that one, boy, you really did this one, and you did that one. And he's going to weigh the scale, and depending upon which one weighs the most, he's going to decide whether I get in or not. I'm so glad God's not fair. I'm so glad God looks at me and says, Bob, it's not all about how well you keep the book. It's about how well you put your trust in me. It's about how well you believe I'm going to be your Savior. It's about how well you're able to look at me and say, I'm going to trust you and I'm going to try to live for you because I know you're going to give me the life I want and I'm going to do what I can, but God, help me. I will never measure up to the things in this book. I don't have it in me. I can't be perfect. And thank God I don't have to be. Thank God he doesn't keep a list. We sang that song this morning. Our sins are thrown into a sea that has no bottom and has no shore. I love that idea. There is no shore. And you think, well, how's that possible? I don't know how it's possible, but you know, if it had a shore, some of those sins would wash up on it, wouldn't they? And they'd show up once in a while. But when God puts our sins away, they are gone. He doesn't bring them back. He doesn't sit up there in heaven and send me a missile every once in a while and say, Bob, remember, I've marked all these sins you've done. You need to think about them and what a jerk you are. I know what a jerk I am. I don't need God reminding me of that. And I am so thankful that God, in his unfairness, takes all my sins and just washes them away. And church, he does that for you. Every sin you've ever committed, if your faith and trust is in Jesus Christ, they've all been forgiven. And not only are they forgiven, they're forgotten. I shared it before, and I'll share it again because I love it. Tony Campolo says he showed up at the gates of heaven. Jesus is there, and he says to Peter, "Peter, go get the book on Tony Campolo." Peter says, "Book? Lord, we got a library on this guy." And so they go get this book, and they bring it back to the front, and they're going to open up, and Tony Campolo says, "I'm just in this dream imagining. Here's this list and list and list that never ends of the things I've done wrong." And they open up the book, and there's not a thing written on it, because they've all been wiped clean by the blood of Jesus. Church, that's us. If we're in God's kingdom, that's us. It's certainly not fair that our sins are responsible for Jesus hanging on a cross. And God says, "I forgive you." It's certainly not fair that we've gone through so many parts of our lives doing things we shouldn't have done, and God says, "I will not only not hold these against you, but you won't have to pay a penalty for them." How many of you have ever told your kids, "You know, I forgive you, but you're going to have to suffer the consequences. I still love you, but there's a paddling coming at the end of the day." God doesn't do that to us. Don't misunderstand me. It doesn't mean that you don't sometimes pay consequences in this life for things you do. But God's not punishing us because of the sins we do, because God has forgiven us for those sins. And out of total joy and thankfulness, we should want to live the way God wants us to live. If you're in Christ Jesus, you are saved. You're not more saved because you live right. You're not less saved if you mess up. You're simply saved. That may not be fair as far as the world counts fairness. I'm glad God doesn't do it that way. I'm glad He just says, "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden. I will give you rest." That's my prayer for us this morning. Is that if you're struggling with something in your life and you're thinking, "You know, I'm a rotten Christian. How can God love me? How can God let me get away with this? I try and I try and I try, and over and over and over I do the same thing, and I just can't seem to quit." And sometimes because of that, you want to quit. You want to think, "I'll just stop showing up at the building. I'll stop thinking about God. I'll just give up." Because that's the way the world would do us. God doesn't do us that way. God says, "I still love you. I still forgive you. I still want you." But He knows when we're in that kind of a mood that we're not out praising God. We're not telling other people about the goodness of God. And God knows if we will accept His grace, His mercy, His forgiveness, His love, and we'll understand just what a magnitude that is, we'll tell everybody. We'll be so full of joy at what God's done for us that we'll want it for them. That's what will make us evangelists. That's what will enable us to go into all the world and make disciples, because we've experienced the forgiveness and the love of God, and we want Him to show it to them and have them feel it too. But if we're always beating ourselves up, we don't have much to offer. At least we don't think we have much to offer. So, church, I'm here this morning to encourage us. Let go of the guilt. Let go of the disappointment. Let go of the sense of fairness and unfairness from the world's view, and just accept the mercy of God that He offers us. Let's pray. Father God, we are so thankful that Your love and mercy doesn't hinge on how good I am. Doesn't depend on what I can do for you, but that God, you simply love us and you want us. What an awesome thought. You want us. And God, we can have that victory that we sing about because we're in Jesus. We can expect to be in that mansion one day because we are in Jesus. Because you love us. And you've put the only measurement out there is, will I put my faith and trust in Jesus? And every one of us can do that. And that's what you ask. So God, my prayer this morning for every one of us in this building, every one of us watching online, is that we will accept the fact that you love us all the same, that you don't stop loving us when we're bad. You don't want to throw us out when we're not measuring up. You don't judge us the way the world judges us by what do we have to offer. But instead, you've already made the offer. You've already offered Jesus. And as he hung on that cross, he paid the price for all of our sins. God, thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. My hope this morning is that we'll find that joy God offers us, that we will live in him in such a way that even when we do things we know we shouldn't be doing, that we'll appreciate the fact that God still loves me. His blood has washed me clean, and I'll want to stop doing those things because I want to praise him, because I want to show him my love. But even when I screw it up and I don't do it right, don't ever forget, God still loves you. God will never let you go as you hang on to Jesus. He'll never pry your fingers off and throw you away. All he asks is that you come to him. So if you're here this morning and you're struggling with something like that, I hope this lesson today will encourage you to realize what a great God we have. And maybe in a way encourage you to try to stop doing those things because you know how much greater your joy and peace could be, not because you think God will love you more, but because you will feel his love more. Maybe you've got some other things you'd like to share, a prayer request, a praise, something going on in your life. We'd love to pray about that this morning. If you've got anything you'd like to share, let's stand and sing our invitation song.
Marvelous grace, loving Lord, grace that exceeds my sin and my guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mountain poured, there in the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace
seated for a moment. Paul came up and said that Evelyn is feeling some pain in her back and neck, and she had hoped to come to Max's services this evening, but because of that, she's not going to be able to, and would you please be praying for Evelyn? And so we'll certainly do that. Donnie came up and just said, I just want to praise God for the safe trip that he and Rhonda had, and would we continue to pray for his family? If you remember, his brother passed not very long ago. And he said, I'm just thankful for all God does for us. And certainly we are too, right? We have an awesome God. Kaylin came up and said, yeah, I'm trying out for a team this Tuesday, and would you just pray that I do well and that I make that team? And so we can certainly do that. And Anna came up to say she's got an HR test later this week on Saturday, and she's been studying for that, hoping to do well. It gives her a certificate that makes her more attractive, not physically because she's a beautiful girl anyway, but more attractive to the hiring world. And so she's hoping to get that, if you'd be in prayer for that as well. John? Okay. Mary Lou and Dennis, as we talked about already, are down in Florida. Their trailer got totaled. They're doing okay, but they'll be coming back, and they've got to make decisions concerning that. Bob and Susan have been traveling. They're starting to come back, I think, tomorrow. So if you'll keep them in your prayers as well. Then Richard Wright is over in Vanderbilt going through his stem cell treatments. Things are looking very positive for him. And so we're thankful for that. But if you'd keep him and Kathy in your prayers as well. Let's pray. God, we're so thankful that your grace is greater than all our sin. Thankful, Father, that you cleanse us. And in front of you, we can stand redeemed and whole, holy and blameless. Thank you for that. Thank you for loving us so much that you sent Jesus to die on a cross for us. God, we do pray for physical needs as well. We pray for Evelyn. We pray that you would take her pain away. God, we pray that you would be with Donnie and Rhonda. Thank you for the safe trip they had. But God, we pray for their family. We pray as they continue to recover from the death in their family. God, we're just so thankful for all that you do for us. We pray your blessings with Caitlin. We pray your blessings with Anna. Father, as they're going through some tests and experiences this week, that they're just going to rely upon you to take care of them and to help them. And so we offer them to you, praying, God, that you'll work in their lives and do what needs to be done for them. God, we do thank you that Richard is doing so well and pray that that continues. We pray that you'd be with Bob and Susan as they're going to be traveling back home from Missouri. I believe tomorrow, starting home tomorrow, that you'd keep them safe as well. Be with Veronica as she's traveling. Be with Valerie's friend, Heidi. And God, whatever's going on with her. And God, again, we pray for Becky. We pray for the Pickering family. Praying, God, your comfort and peace to be with them as they go through these trials. And Father, I'd add Brenda Hammond as well, as she's looking at moving up, I believe it's to Michigan. Pray, God, that as though that happens, that as she goes through the things that need to be done for that to occur, that you'll be with her as she goes through that. God, I pray for my little sister, Anita, who's been diagnosed with cancer and who's having to make decisions now on what kind of treatment she's going to have. And I just pray you give her the wisdom to make the correct decision there. God, thank you for being with us today. Thank you for your grace and mercy. It's beyond words how much you love us. But we're so thankful that you do. Thank you that you're not fair like the world counts fairness, but your love is overwhelming. We praise you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. You may have noticed through the years that we rotate who's doing communion meditation by having a different elder do it every month. And since you elected me as an elder last summer, they decided I need to take a turn once in a while to do this as well. And I said, well, of course I'd be happy to. And May's my month. You know, the neat thing about being up here and being able to share with you the Lord's Supper is I've already been up here talking to you already. And I don't know a better way to say what we're doing now other than the words that I've spoken and the songs that we've sung. It's the blood of Jesus that makes it possible for us to be his children. It's the blood of Jesus that makes it possible for us to be cleansed. And Jesus, as he instituted this communion at the Passover, he took that bread and he took that wine that was used to commemorate the salvation they got from Egypt thousands of years before. And he said, this will now be a memory of what I'm doing for you, because in a very real sense, he sets us free. His broken body, his shed blood is what takes us out of slavery. Slavery to sin. The inability to save ourselves. And the only requirement he had was this: do this in remembrance of me. So as you take this little piece of bread and you drink this little bit of juice, be thinking about what Jesus did for us. The sacrifice he made. How much he loves us. For those who are visiting with us, our practice is we come by rows down the center aisle. We have a double stacked cup. The bread's on the bottom, juice is in the top. Take those, go on the outside aisle and go back to your seat. And then we all participate in the Lord's Supper at the same time. And if you're visiting with us, we do an open communion. You're more than happy or more than welcome to come down and join us and participate with us in the Lord's Supper. Father, we thank you for the blessings you give us. We thank you now that we can remember you, specifically the sacrifice that you made through Jesus Christ, so that our sins could be forgiven, that we could live with you forever. Help us to reflect on that as we go through this exercise. In Jesus' name, amen. You may come forward. The Bible says that on that night before he was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it, passed it amongst his disciples, and he said, this is my body broken for you. Later in that meal, he took the cup. He passed it amongst his disciples and he said, drink, this is my blood shed for you. Our collection basket is in the back. John? Okay. Who did? Oh, okay. Okay. So Eva says thank you for the prayers we gave her for her back surgery. She's doing well. And Kevin Clement's sister passed away, so we need to be in prayer for that as well. I don't want to be remiss and not say thank you to those of you who work so hard to make this back inside area of the church Looks so pretty. It looks very nice. Thank you for those who showed up yesterday and did all of that. We appreciate the work that you did for that. Yes, that's worth a clap. Put on your calendar the June 5th date. Again, that's from 5 to 7 p.m. Hoping for a beautiful day. We'll sing first. Bring your lawn chairs, and we'll feed you after we sing. Invite your friends. You got people that love to sing. Invite them to come join us. We're doing it outside so we can sing without masks. That's the ideal. Is we're going to be out without masks, and we're going to separate people as far as we can out there on the front lawn. We got plenty of space. The town said we can do it. They won't close the road for us, but they don't care if we're loud and obnoxious and whatever we want to be. They said knock yourself out. So we'll do that, and that's June the 5th. So put that on your calendar and come sing with us. I'm looking forward to that day and that event. It's also an outreach opportunity for us and our community. So again, if you've got some neighbors or friends that you think would like to join us, drag them along with a lawn chair, and we'll just make an evening out of it. Any other announcements? From 5 to 7. Isn't that right? Yeah. Anybody else? All right. Appreciate you guys. Thanks again for being here today. If you're online, thank you for being online. Remember, Mac's service today, viewing is 4 to 6. Service will take place sometime right after that. Be in prayer for Becky and the family. I'm sure they would appreciate that very much. Becky is doing well. I'm visiting with her. She's handling this as well as you can expect after 58 years of marriage. So, but keep them in your prayers if you would. I know they'd appreciate that. And then tomorrow's internment will be at Monte Vista Memorial Park up on Oakland and Johnson City at 10 o'clock. Let's pray. God, we thank you again for being with us today. Thank you for the grace that you show us. Thank you that you don't judge us the way the world does, but you just accept us just as we are. Knowing, Father, that your love and compassion will change us into the people you want us to be. But even then, you are so patient. You allow us, Father, to make mistakes, to do dumb things, but you still love us. You still forgive us. You still welcome us. Thank you for that. We give you the praise. We give you the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Be blessed, church.